Hello, everybody, and welcome to our November 18th Select Board meeting. We're starting at 6 o'clock, but for those of you at home watching this, you'll realize that you're not watching it on the 18th. We have some things going on here, and I'm going to explain what we're going to do, and then we'll start the meeting off. So we have an executive session that we're going to go into first thing, and then we will come out of executive session to take a position from that discussion. Hopefully, if we can come to an agreement. And then we'll go into our regular meeting. So probably a lot of people, this is all gonna be taped, so you're hearing the introduction, there's gonna be a little space, and then we'll be back to our meeting. You won't even know what happened, actually. So when we go into executive session, we're gonna start with just the select board, the planning board, and town council in the room. And then as this meeting goes on, executive session goes on, then we'll bring in Mr. Pill, and we have some, and invite him to join us. Okay. So, do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to go into executive session to discuss strategy of a pending litigation, and is determined that if an open meeting may be detrimental and effective on the bargaining or litigation position of the public body, and the chair so declares. Five Colleges, Inc., and Hadley Planning Board.
Okay, there's a motion.
Second.
Roll call.
Roll call vote, Devine?
Yes.
Maureen?
Yes.
Chungo?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Okay, as chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the board has moved and seconded to enter into an executive session. And I state that the discussion of this matter in open session would have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley. We will reconvene and start a regular meeting after this executive session. Thank you. Okay. All right, so we're back into open session. First thing we're going to do is we're going to report on what we did during our executive session. Our executive session was to discuss a legal issue we have, and the action of the board during that discussion was to appoint Michael Pill as a special town administrator, a special town council for the issue with the planning board and Five Colleges, Inc. The vote was 3-1 in favor of doing that. So, with that appointment, we'll approve a contract with Mr. Pill, and then we'll move forward in that case. So, and I apologize for everyone who is waiting outside for us to start our meeting. So I'm going to do one quick 7:15 appointment, and then we'll go into the SWOT analysis. So we have a 7:15 appointment with Miss... Oh, I can never pronounce your
name. I was going to let you try.
That's okay.
Where are we?
Rera. My name is Elizabeth Rera, and I'm a planner with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. And we're here to talk about our fiscal year 16 community development block grant application. I hope to be here under different circumstances, celebrating all the money that we got in the last round, but unfortunately our application was not successful. So we're here tonight to talk about an updated application for the next grant cycle, and the application we do in February once again. Just as a refresher, for those that might not be familiar with the program, the Community Development Block Grant Program is funded under Title I of the Housing and Community Development Act. It's funding that comes from HUD through the Department of Housing and Community Development here in Massachusetts. And the primary objective of the program is to develop viable urban communities by providing decent housing and suitable living environments and expanding economic opportunities for low and moderate income persons. And DHCD will fund eligible projects in order to meet those criteria. And the projects that are eligible under CDBG funding include housing rehabilitation, sign and facade improvements, senior neighborhood youth centers, architectural barrier removal, infrastructure projects, and the like. So those are the types of programs that they look for at DHCD when we apply. Last year's application was a joint application with Belchertown. And as you know, there are several tiers of the CDBG program in Massachusetts. There's entitlement communities, which get money automatically. There's mini entitlements, which get a little less money automatically. Then there's what we call CDF1 communities, which have a high level of need, and CDF2 communities, which also have need. Belchertown and Hadley both fall into the CDF2 category, which means it's a very highly competitive grant process. Last year, there were five applications for CDF2 funding, and they funded two of them. So unfortunately, we didn't hit the cutoff for where we could be funded. We would like to apply again. We would like to pursue another application with Hadley and Belchertown. And as you know, in the past, we have been successful in fiscal year 12. Just a few years ago, we received almost $900,000 in a Belchertown Hadley Granby grant for housing rehabilitation and a regional housing authority improvement project.
What portion of that came to Hadley?
You know, I'm not sure exactly what it was. It doesn't work out to thirds exactly, but it was something close to that.
There were significant upgrades over at the over Gold Court as a result of that of that grant.
Absolutely. The maximum request that we can do for a joint application of this nature is $900,000, so we'll come as close to that as we can when we structure the program and the grant. Belchertown has, again, agreed to be the lead community, which really means they do a little more paperwork, but it doesn't necessarily grant them any more money in the grant. So let's talk about my suggestions for our FY16 grant. Last year, the most successful grant applications included only housing rehabilitation and social services. Our grant application included housing rehabilitation, social services, and additional work at the Hadley Housing Authority to pave a portion of the family section of the Housing Authority project over at Golden Court. My suggestion would be that this year we strictly look for funding for housing rehabilitation and social services. Those seem to be the strongest applications that they are tending to fund these days. So that would be my recommendation moving forward. That being said, if there are additional projects that Hadley is interested in pursuing, we can have the discussion, you know, about them. But from a grant writing perspective, that would be probably the most competitive grant that we could put together. In the last grant that we wrote, Hadley was going to have 4 units of housing rehab in our target area, as well as a local civilian police advocacy service run through the police department. And that was also going to happen in Belchertown as well. And then a MedRide program in Belchertown, which are the 2 social service pieces, and then the Hadley Housing Authority improvement to the parking area. In a grant that didn't include the Hadley Housing Authority, you could probably be looking at an additional 10 to 12 units of housing rehabilitation, which is significant. Right now, the wait list that we have going is, I believe, 23 units in Hadley and 24 to 26 units in Belchertown. And we continue to get phone calls asking to be put on the wait list. And we keep telling them we're not funded at this time, but we'll keep your information and let you know when money becomes available. So there is need, there is desire for that type of program. And certainly doing 12 to 14 units would be a significant, address a significant portion of that list.
Okay.
So that being said, it's obviously the board's,
So we need to make a decision if we want to do this, join this.
Well, February is when the application submitted?
So from a town perspective, what your part in this would be our meeting tonight, and I have a sign-in sheet going around. That's very important for everyone to sign in. It'll come around to the select board as well. We would also have a public hearing on the grant, either late December or early January, where we would officially decide, discuss the money totals and what social service organizations might be included in the grant. And then, I do the hard work and write the thing and submit it on your behalf in February.
Okay. So is there any more discussion about do we want to do this or?
Kind of a no-brainer, isn't it?
No.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Thank you for
So is there a motion?
I'll make a motion.
I'll second Joyce's motion.
Okay. Any more discussion?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good luck.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
She just needs this.
Susan, do you have a card?
Pardon?
You have a card for her?
Do I have mine? I do.
Okay, so now we're going to jump into our SWOT analysis, which we will have only the SWOT from the seniors tonight. We're going to have the schools on the 2nd, December 2nd meeting.
What about the other appointment? We're not doing that?
We'll do that. We'll let, she was supposed to go first.
Okay, no.
Should I assume you all have copies?
Got it.
You do. Thank you.
Thank you.
So when the department heads were asked to do this, although it takes a little while to put some information together, I welcomed the opportunity to do some education around exactly what the Council on Aging does, because I think it's not clear to a lot of the population that doesn't utilize it or have somebody they know that utilizes it. So it might have been a little broader in scope than some of the others that you read. Starting with an overview, I don't want to read it line by line, but certainly, going over the organizations and the funding, we're charged with trying to make sure that the people 60 plus in Hadley can maintain an economic standard of living, remain in their homes, afford their medicines, be active, stay healthy, and have access to resources that are necessary to maintain that standard of living. We don't want anybody being isolated. We also want the community at large to be educated as to where they can go to get these resources, such as Meals on Wheels, or fuel assistance, or food stamps, or any of the things, or even a small thing like a prescription advantage, which goes towards helping towards the cost of prescription drugs, which have gone up and up and up. So all of those small measures are key little pieces to not whittling away at the fixed income for people to be able to heat their houses, eat nutritious meals, put gas in their cars, go for a hike, go out to dinner, live well. So when we take what we have, not counting the building costs, just administrative costs, and what we get from the state in the form of a formula grant, we're looking at a total of $88,027, which breaks down to spending about $63 per person per senior in town, using the 2010 census figures of 1,389 seniors in Hadley, which is about 26% of your population. So what I find kind of more to the point is that in this study, it gave me the opportunity to say, this is what we're looking at and how we're struggling with it now. And when you look at the overarching dollars that are out there from the federal level down, it's not a pretty picture moving forward for the masses that are going to be growing. And everybody's kind of late on getting on the bandwagon, on figuring out how this is going to happen. And that's actually, I just got a thing from dated November 13th from Massachusetts Council on Aging that came from the CSDRA's municipal project. They're looking for an enterprising, analytical individual interested in preparing Massachusetts for dramatic growth of older adults, which I thought was better late than never. Somewhere within the next 5 months, I've heard that there will be more people in the United States over the age of 60 than there are people 20 and under. I thought that was shocking when I heard that. I mean, you just look around, you see young people everywhere, and it kind of puts it in perspective when you think about that there's more people over the age of 60. So we have additional funding that can come through in service incentive grants, Title III grants from area agencies on aging. I mentioned these in the report as overarching senior care agencies. Our area agency on aging is Highland Valley Elder Services in Florence, Massachusetts. They get state funding and a little bit of federal funding to administer Meals on Wheels, the congregate meal sites. They're also some of the gateway for elder protective services, ombudsman, things like that. There is in your SWOT one of the attachments in the back which give all of the duties that those ASAPs are in charge of. So there's several studies in here that can be cited, and I'm not sure how well you were able to kind of get a sense of where senior economic statuses are. Massachusetts is actually, Vermont is last in the state for how well seniors do economically, and Massachusetts is second behind that in the country, which is pretty telling. So there's definitely a need. Our numbers are going to be continuing to grow, as you all know, from all of the studies that are out there.
Suzanne, what are your numbers currently?
Well, we don't get an updated census. We wait for the next one. So we have to go with the 1389 according to that latest thing, and that's where our funding gets.
Does everybody, do all 1,300 of those people use your services?
No, not all 1,300 use our services, but all 1,300 of them are made aware of our services through our newsletter, which gets mailed to every household with anybody 60 or older in Hadley. So they have a way of knowing what is out there and how to get a hold of it. I know there's a lot of bullet points in here, and I'm not sure where you want to start or if you need answers on any of them in particular, or if you want me to just go through the whole thing.
Why don't we just go to page 5 where you have it all analyzed,
okay.
The actual SWOT.
How about the true ones you feel are the biggest things we need to address this year or try to think about this year?
Some of them we've already addressed. We have a lot of great strengths. You know, we do great outreach. We have a nurse, we have a veterans officer. We have healthcare professionals, which are really utilized. We have, in my narrative, I told you we had 5 exercise classes. We now have 7 exercise classes. We have a great triad salt group. We've just rolled out the lockbox, which has also been in Belchertown, Amherst, South Hadley, I would say that our biggest need, that's a hard one because there's a few of them, I think we're tired. We've gotten very busy, and we're going to get busier, and we're short-staffed. But the building is getting very cold right now, and it's not very comfortable during the summer either. This is definitely an issue insofar as what we can hold for programs seasonally. I would say we're doing the job that we need to do for the people, which is being a human service agency and keeping tabs and keeping our ear to the ground and trying to meet all those needs. When we couldn't get a grant for an additional day of transportation to get people in medical appointments, we started a friends group, and we got the money to do that, and it's been piloted since late August. So we worked on that, and we've dealt with that. It's starting to really catch on. I think staffing and and the environment, I would say, are our biggest issues.
Building environment or natural environment?
Building environment. No, we have great working relationships with everybody that comes in. We really do. I mean, we're good at coordinating, right? Anybody we can partner with, we do, and it goes a long way. It goes a long way towards getting everybody on the same page and spreading our resources and letting the town feel that we're out there for them, you know, that they can come to us.
Suzanne, can I just ask, in terms of the space, you mentioned that the space is limiting your programming right now. Do you have any sense between the exercise classes, the lunch program, tax services, all the things that happen in the senior center, just roughly how many people are being serviced now, and if the space situation was improved, how that might expand or not?
Yes. I'm guesstimating because I'm still in the beginning stages of, we lost our office manager, and so I'm still tabulating things when I have the time to do it, in addition to everything else. But I'm going to say that we see between either one time a year or another, I'm going to say that we probably see at least 800 out of those 13, even if they only come in for one time a year for their flu shot or it's a referral for something or what have you. Insofar as environment and how I see numbers going, it's been studied by Executive Office of Builder Affairs that when they have a great environment, specifically in the study of senior centers, new senior centers, they see their numbers jump at least half immediately afterwards within 18 months.
Okay. Any other questions?
Well, I just had one. It's kind of a hot question. Our last meeting, the library trustees came in with their plans for, looks like, knocking down the senior center and putting up a new library, which was kind of a shock to a couple of us anyway. I hadn't heard of that up until that point. So that, of course, would displace the seniors. Any thoughts on that?
I'm at this point, I'm looking at it as an exercise. I know that at some point, the older buildings aren't going to be able to be used for the purposes that they're going to be used for. So whether it's at this time or in the future, I'm going to need to go through this exercise. I have my own personal preferences, but I'm not a Hadley resident and I'm not a senior. I'm an advocate for them. They told me last year at an open forum they'd love to have one floor, new environment with, you know, this, that, and the other thing, and not sharing space with anybody. They wanted it to be their own. That's what they said a year ago. Right now, what I'm waiting for is for everybody to agree on a plan, for all of the interested parties to be heard from, and to try and get as close to everyone's needs as possible, and then let the voters decide.
What a great idea.
That's too simple.
Yeah. I'm glad you've had some thought on it, and I guess that's what I was looking for, and that's fine. Thank you. I appreciate it. And I'm sure there'll be more discussion on it eventually.
Do you have something to say about her SWAT, or you want to talk about the building?
No, it has to do with a letter that was supposedly sent to the selectmen on this very idea here at the senior center and the library.
Okay.
And the recreation center. The senior center and the recreation center before the library. But you were supposed to have been sent this today, so you would have it for your meeting tonight.
We don't.
And then you didn't take, well, probably got lost in the email, but you will be getting some notification of what the building committee is working on to alleviate that problem that they are having there. Help out with that.
With the heating?
Actually, the heating works very well in the summer, I understand.
Yeah.
It's nice and toasty.
We need to reverse that a little bit for them. For sure.
Thank you.
We shouldn't have to be using space heaters, for sure.
I'll be happy to get you any information you need if you require it, so please just ask.
Yeah.
All right.
Thanks.
Don't you have a holiday party coming up that you want to talk
about? We have a holiday party happening thanks to the Police and Firemen's Association at the Hadley Farms Meeting House December 3rd, and the Ray of Elvis will be there, and it's a spectacular buffet, and you can all look at all the Christmas trees up for auction and have a good time. The tickets are available at the Senior Center for $15. See you there.
Fabulous.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. So, Chief Mason. While you're plugging in, we're going to talk about our consent agenda. So on our consent agenda, we're taking off the minutes.
Correct.
So we have a common vic license for Johnny's Roadside Diner, the first and last payment for U.S. Metal Roofing for the DPW garage. We have a resignation from Officer Harding, Special Officer Harding. We have a resignation of a Conservation Board member, Paul Alexanderson. W.M. Schultz, pay request number 16 for $51,000.
And number 15, is that on there?
No, just number 16. And number 15?
Yeah.
Pay request number 15 and 16. And then we have a change order for W.M. Schultz as well. Is there anything anybody wants to take off, or are we okay to approve all of these?
No additions or deletions.
No additions or deletions.
I'll make the motion to accept all.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. How goes it, Chief?
Looks good. I tested this earlier, so if it doesn't work now, this was never meant to be.
Do you want to do something else while you keep playing?
I think it'll come up.
We can do all of the business number one. That'll take no time.
There goes my.
No, that'll take some time.
Right.
It will?
Yes.
Non-binding?
Yes.
Why?
Just in case the whole thing fails, this is a paper copy for you. I've already put one in the finance committee's pocket downstairs.
I thought it was the protected one.
Hey, Mike.
It's the second protected.
Two sided next to
it? Yeah, that's their mine.
Yeah, and I don't know where that staple landed like that.
While we're waiting, we'll do one more business. Electric rates.
Electric rates, yes. So we have a fixed price contract for electricity through the Hampshire Power Organization, and that.
You want to go into a 3-year contract instead?
Yeah, so that extends until October 1st, 2016, so about a quarter of the way into next fiscal year. That price per kilowatt hour is 11.63 cents. I've asked them to go out and what's called blend in and extend to see if we can get prices for an extension of that contract at a fixed rate, and they've come back with a number of bid results. The lowest price at about 9.9 cents per kilowatt hour is for a 12-month period, which is certainly less than what we're doing. It's very favorable. But the 36-month one is for 10.5 cents per kilowatt hour, which is still a penny less than what we're currently paying, and I think that we should lock in a 3-year contract, which would extend it to October 1st, 2019, and know what our electricity costs are going to be for the next 3 years.
Brass tacks, what are we saving?
We would be saving something on the order of minimum $5,000 per year for a three-year period, so it's $15,000 just on that part alone. All the other discounts that we received through net metering credits would still apply, and we'd be receiving those discounts, which are 70% of our load gets a 21% discount. And then we're currently negotiating. We've already approved a reduction of 16% for the remaining 30% of our load.
The 5,000 would be on top of the 16.
That's correct. Right. That's a minimum, and my crystal ball tells me that the fuel prices, which are ultimately the driver of electricity over the next 3 years, are only going to rise. So I would take that as a very conservative view. We spend a quarter of $1 million per year on electricity alone as a town, so anything that we can do to shave some pennies off of that, we should do.
I'll make a motion to accept the three-year rate at 10.5.
Second.
Any more discussion?
You know, when you said $5,000 a year, it sounded like a lot, but when you said we spend a quarter million a year, it doesn't sound like a lot, does it?
Take what we can get.
But you're locked in for 3 years, which is the best part of this.
That's the thing that's good. Motion second on floor, Chair.
Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. We see you're ready now.
I'm ready. Okay. This is the cost-benefit analysis that we put together for our test program that we did in July and August to see if we could put a program in place for the future of our department that would help to reduce some of the overtime. I brought the gentleman behind me because they've kind of assisted me with the scheduling of the program, you know, check the math, and I actually presented them this presentation to see if I missed anything or we should add something. So if my brain's not working fast enough, if there's any questions, they may jump in and help out. This is how I see our department spends overtime. The majority of our overtime is spent because of a manpower issue and because of minimum mandatory rules that are set forth by our collective bargaining agreement. We are always at what we call minimum staffing. So whether it's the summertime or whether it's the school year, we have a certain amount of officers that are on duty, and anytime any one of those officers is absent for whatever reason, we have to backfill that shift with overtime. That's just what the contract says we have to do. Compound that with some of the other issues that we have, like court investigations, training mandates, which go up every single year, our specialized training that we try to get people certified to do certain things to move our department forward. All of these things take people away from patrols and cause even more overtime. So just to give you an example, this is what I just took a snapshot basically of what our schedule looked like August 30th and 31st of 2014. This, all of the numbers that are not boxed are officers that are regularly scheduled. All of the orange colored box, the rust colored boxes, that is all overtime. Those are shifts that someone was absent, called in sick, took a vacation day, took a personal day, whatever it is, and someone backfilled that shift with overtime. In a two-day period, that's what that cost us. That's just using our median overtime rate, about $30 an hour, $2,100. And just real quickly, it should be noted that those two white boxes with the asterisks, those are part-time officers that took those shifts, but those both could have gone to overtime. They went through overtime, and the officers just said no to them or couldn't work them. You're talking about another $450, $500 that could have been spent on that day.
Could you back that up, please? I got a couple of questions. So the 340 that we're looking at the top line on the left-hand side, what does that represent?
That's an officer. That's an ID number.
It's an ID.
Okay.
Yeah, I probably should have pointed that out. All the numbers there are identification numbers of all the officers. They all represent a person that works for us. That's an actual, like I said, an actual snapshot of what that day looked like. 340, took the day off, 349, took that shift. That's how that worked.
Okay.
Didn't someone have to backfill 349 shift? Is that on?
Yeah, what it looks like is that day
349
also took the day off or was absent maybe for court or an investigation or a training. And he worked an overnight midnight shift for overtime, and then 352 took 349's shift. So like I said, that's what we spent. That's real. That's an actual number. So essentially, these are the questions that we had, and we tried to develop a test program to answer them. How do we solve this problem? If we keep our officers at a safe minimum mandatory level of 2 officers, which is safe in most situations, that's bare minimum, basically. What does it cost to staff more full-time officers? Would we actually be able to reduce the overtime if we staffed more officers? Could we solve any of those other problems we talked about with court, invests, things like that? And perhaps, in my mind at least, handling the budget, perhaps most importantly, can we better predict our annual overtime costs? Can we actually budget for this? The last 3 or 4 budgets, I think, that have been put in have had the same number in that box over the last 2 or 3 years, because no one knows what it's going to be, and we overrun it every year. So here's what we did. Essentially, I had to go to the union, and I think you know this, you folks actually had to vote on it. I went to the police union because we had to alter some of the contract language for these 2 months so that we could put this plan into place. And essentially what we wanted to do is add part-time and special officers to simulate adding full-time officers. We added 1 to every single shift to get us above that minimum mandatory staffing level of 2. The union understood what we were trying to do, what the idea behind this was, and they were willing to forego the overtime that they would have gotten throughout the summertime. And it was a significant amount of overtime, because you're talking about all the vacation time that people take during the summer. So we had to ask for a little bit of extra money to do this, because we didn't have budgeted the extra money that we would needed to put those part-time and specials on. And the bottom part there, what we did, this is perhaps one of the most important parts of the actual project, is most time off policies in police departments, when they have minimum mandatory staffing, allow you to use your accrued time so long as you don't cause overtime, unless you're calling out sick or something like that. So essentially, we adjusted the policy for these 2 months and allowed people to take last minute time off if they were cleared by a supervisor, so long as we didn't fall below that minimum mandatory staffing. When the officers took those days off, we didn't backfill that shift. So we were actually at a disadvantage throughout the summer because we did have 2 vacant shifts. We had 1 officer in the academy and another officer who was on medical leave at the time. This put us at a disadvantage because we were forced to use a lot of the officers who would have been the additional officers to fill those 2 shifts. This is 4 shifts a week. We work a 4-and-2 schedule. So you're talking about 8 shifts every week. We had to pull people and put on those shifts, which kind of didn't allow us to put as many people on. So the fact that I think that this was a success shows even better what we can do if we're not at this type of a disadvantage. So, as I said, when a full-time officer was absent for any reason and the extra officer shift was filled, we didn't backfill it, and we ran with a minimum staff of 2. So here's what it looked like. July, we didn't force people to take these shifts, which is why you don't see 40 extra shifts and 40 people working them, only because it would have been an extra step, an extra problem that we would have had to deal with. But of those 40, we filled 35 of them. What it costs us in actual money is about $4,100. The number of prevented overtime shifts during that same time period is 24 and a half shifts. And we have the half in there only because we have these weird offset shifts, and every once in a while we're able to fill half but not the other half. So at our median overtime rate, those 24 and a half shifts would have cost us $5,800. That's what we were what we didn't have to spend. August, I'm not going to read all the numbers, but you can see it's even higher. 29 and a half shifts we were able to prevent, and that's at $7,000. That's what we would have spent. So what you're looking at here, I had a difficult time deciding what to call this number. I tossed around savings, reduction, things like that. I don't want to mislead anyone.
It's cost avoidance.
Cost avoidance, that's probably...
You should have called me.
There you go. I didn't want to mislead anyone with the number, but I also didn't want to downplay the fact that this is cost avoidance. These are monies that we did not have to spend because of the money that we did spend on putting those extra people on. So to simplify it, that's a reduction in spending out of our operational budget. That's what those two numbers represent in those 2 months. So both months combined, like I said, I'm not gonna read it over, but you can look very, very quickly at the bottom. Our potential reduction in overtime throughout those 2 months is about $4,600. It's 35%, and that's, I don't mean to harp on it, but that's a very limited time period. We're talking about 2 months, and we're talking about Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and a day shift on Sunday. We did it that way because we knew those were the days that most people take off. Those were the days that we needed the extra patrols anyways. So you're talking about us putting extra shifts on 4 days out of the seven. So it's a very limited time period. This part, I don't mean to confuse anybody, but being completely open and forthright, these actual costs are not exactly what we would be spending if we had added full-time people to our staff. Only because 15 of those total number of shifts that we were able to fill, we did fill with a special. They work at a lesser rate. It doesn't change the numbers too much, but it changes them enough that I wanted to have full disclosure on this. So when you look at it, you'll see that the actual cost increase is a few hundred dollars, and the potential cost avoidance is reduced by a few hundred dollars. It's not a tremendous amount, but it's enough that it's worth noting. So this is what I believe that adding an additional full-time police officer, this is what I believe we could accomplish by doing this. I really believe we can reduce the amount of overtime that we spend. We can increase manpower, we can increase productivity, and invest in the future of our police department. As I said earlier, we can gain control of the overtime, be able to predict and actually budget for it. We can create a detective position. That is already in the works. That is something that I'm already thinking about. If we can get additional people on, one of those people can be a detective. We can hopefully create maybe a senior administrative supervisor position. I know that's something that the board has been looking for quite some time now. And, as said in the beginning, court invests, training. These things become almost inconsequential because of the fact that if an officer has court, let's say they work a day shift or they work an evening shift or whatever it is, and they have to leave their shift to go do these things, unless there's something crazy going on that we need that extra person there, we don't have to fill their shift. They just go and do the other thing. And they're making the same rate. So, take what we did and go back to those same 2 days in 2014. And you can see right there, all of the red boxes are overtime shifts. We've added new number one, new number two, and new number three. Those are new officers. In doing that, we were able to cut seven of those overtime shifts that we would have had to fill. We still are going to have overtime. We still have to fill shifts. We need to make sure that we keep the officers safe and keep enough people on duty. But we're able to take seven of those shifts out of there. So just operationally, as far as an operational budget goes, it would cost us, I believe, about $880 in salaries on those 2 days for full-time police officers. The overtime goes from $2,100 down to $960. If you add those two numbers together, you just put three new police officers on the road, add their salaries with the reduction in the overtime, and it's still less than what we paid in straight overtime to backfill all 11 of those shifts. Now, I'm not going to go so far as to say that we can reduce that much money in every two-day period, because every two-day period doesn't look like that. However, since everybody, I think, is now curious, throughout a year's time, that's $58,000. While adding a police officer to the road, taking an exhausted officer who's probably working a double off the road and putting a fresh one on. I just wanted to show you folks, this was taken from the actual, from our actual spreadsheets, our actual budget last year and this year, just to show you, I don't have the facts of what, or the statistics of what was going on July through July and August in FY15, so I can't really say, oh, we didn't need to spend $3,900 that week, but this is what it looked like.
It actually should be 14 and 15, not 15 and 16, right?
Yeah, I apologize, you're right.
Okay.
Okay.
But what you do know is in 15, on the right-hand side, you were down two officers.
Right. And we spent $16,000 in overtime as opposed to $25,000. That's with that project going on. More importantly, what I also did was, is I not only went back and looked at the overtime, just because it's kind of a shocking number to see, but I also took our part-time spendings during those both of those time periods, and I combined them, because really what you want to know is overall cost. And that's what that looked like. I did the same thing with the 15 and 16, but the total in those 2 months with the overtime that we spent plus the part-timers is $40,600. This year, $37,529. So you're looking at a $3,000 reduction while adding a police officer to the street every shift, starting on 3 to 11 on Thursday and going to a day shift on Sunday. And being short two officers. So here's the big question. Can we do this? When you think about this objectively, essentially what you think is, well, that's great. We can reduce the overtime by hiring three more cops. Where are we going to get the money to hire three more cops? So we're basically just trading money for money. You know, you're taking it from one account and putting it into another one. That's not true. Because over the years, our police department has become to rely so heavily on part-time people. We even have it in our contract. We have specific shifts designated for part-timer and special officers 9 months out of the year. Because of that, the part-time budget has grown to a point where last year, I believe it was up to 100, that 102,665 is what it was before we asked for the extra money to put on this project. So let's just assume contract negotiations, whatever it is, coming up, I think it was 117. That number is going to continue to get bigger if we don't do anything about it, because we still have to staff those shifts. They're still in the contract. And the off, and bottom line is, we need the manpower. We need those people, those extra people out there during the school years to deal with some of the problems that we have. So, the money's already there. Two-thirds of that money can be taken and moved, and those part-time shifts can be altered to create full-time positions. That's two out of the three that you need to move this plan forward. So if you think back to all the actual cost scenarios that I showed you earlier, basically imagine all of them cut by two-thirds, because that's money that's already allocated. It's already necessary. We have to put it back there every year. Now, I understand hiring new employees. There's a difference between operational costs and what you're going to have to spend for insurance, you know, people with the insurance, workman's comp, and all the other things. I believe it's about 34-35% per person at this point in time. However, looking at this from an operational standpoint, an operational budget standpoint, this makes sense. This plan makes sense. Perhaps more importantly, on a level of productivity, on a level of law enforcement productivity, this is a best practice. Getting yourself above what you have to fill, this is a best practice. You don't have to put those officers out there exhausted, working doubles to get those shifts filled. So there is some bad news. July and August, we spent $16,000 in overtime. Since that time, unfortunately, even with the changes that we've made, we've spent a little over $30,000 from September, when this project ended, up until now. Now, it should be noted that we rolled out of the summer months and into the fall, which is when the students are here, so we have to add those part-time shifts back. Those part-time shifts, if they don't get picked up by part-timers or specials, they go back to overtime. There's any number of ways that our overtime increases outside of the summertime, but you can see how big of a number that is. So we have done as much, well, I shouldn't say that. We have done several things to try to reduce the overtime outside of this plan. We have altered policies. We have changed the way people are allowed to use time off. We have changed the way that we fill our part-time and special shifts. We've broken them up into different blocks to make it easier for some of our part-time people to take those shifts. And all of this, some of this is, I shouldn't say that the union is unhappy about it, but we're at a point right now where a lot of these officers need to decide whether or not they want to grieve some of the things that we're doing, or whether or not they want to allow these things to happen knowing what is possible to come. And as I said earlier, to their credit, we've had no issues, and we've all worked together because we are hoping that in the future, when I present the next budget, or my first budget, with these additional people on here, that we can make that the future of our department. So that's it. It's probably too long as it is.
Any questions?
Something to digest.
Just very, very nice presentation, Mark. Oh, Mike.
Just one thing.
You are.
What is your shifts? When you show those seven, those, when you list this, what is the shift breakdown of that?
The top one is, the top two.
The top two are your midnight shifts.
Yeah.
The top two are your midnight shifts.
The next
two are your day shifts. The next two are your evening shifts. And the last one is 7P to 3A.
Which the 7P to 3A right now, Doug is on. That's his full-time shift because he's got the dog, and the best place for the dog is on those two shifts, second half of eve, first half of mid. That shift would disappear. So essentially, if we hired three, we would get four out of it, and we would build the schedule in a way to use that shift to get those three officers on each patrol. We would still be short two shifts a week, which the plan is to backfill those with part-timers.
So what would Nomar's schedule be?
Well,
whatever Nomar wants.
Whatever
Nomar wants.
Probably be an even bid. The officers are allowed to bid, so we would basically just be, that shift would just disappear. That's why you saw the cut there.
But if that's the need for that shift, for that particular...
It's the need for the shift only because it's kind of a necessity. We have to have that shift right now.
For activity, you mean to handle activity during those
hours?
No,
not necessarily. That's just one of our shifts. So that's a shift that goes out to bid every time.
Right.
So we essentially kind of looked at it, and the busier shifts is half the second half of the evening and the first half of the midnight. So we thought it would be the best place for them for right now.
Okay. So
I'm still working on the budget numbers right now. I've already started.
And to your point about making sure we fully load the costs, so like for employee benefits and things like that. So if, you know, we'll get to this when we get to the actual budget cycle, but if you could make sure that any of that's getting communicated to the town administrator, because he's doing the budget for employee benefits, so we'll want to see, because it's going to show up in two places.
Right, and not only that, but it's going to change, because if it goes, if it's a percentage, we're in negotiations right now, salaries are going to change and things like that. And the other thing I probably should have mentioned, that, you know, it's an afterthought, I didn't want to get too much into it, but, you know, a lot of this is, I shouldn't say wholly dependent upon negotiations, but there are certain things that do need to be altered in the contract that the officers are absolutely behind, so long as this is where we're headed.
Mm-hmm. But, speaking
so it's going to be, it's going to take an effort of finance, select board, town administrator, mm-hmm. union, and we're all going to have to work together.
And speaking of the other officers, so I mean, it sounds like I would imagine some of the intangibles here are, you know, better sleeping patterns potentially, you know, feeling healthier, less sickness, all that stuff that would go along.
No, everything is going to get better. One of the things that kind of goes by the wayside here is that some of the officers take all this overtime because, you know, the salaries aren't great, and they got to take it to make enough money to survive. No, people would say, well, you shouldn't put, you know, you shouldn't base your salary on overtime, but this has been going on for a decade and a half. So there comes a point in time where that starts to happen regardless of what your feelings are. Other officers take the overtime because, you know, they're trying to be team players and we got to get these shifts filled. So it's, you know, but you're right, you know, to your point.
I take the overtime because I like the money. I'm not crazy.
Right. But
do it all the time.
You don't base your life on it.
No, but
the thing
nice.
Is it, you're right. I mean, it would yeah. help all of those other issues. We get fresh people on the street, and, you know, they have the energy to go out there and do all the things that we expect of our police officers to do. Mm-hmm. It's not a tiny little quiet town anymore. There's stuff out there.
Well, it gives them an opportunity too. At some point, that they can, if they're not picking up the overtime, they would be available to do the offered shifts, and a lot of times they're offered to out-of-town officers
details, right.
or details and things, which, you know, pay good money.
Moving right along.
Yeah. So I, you know, I'm just saying that.
Guilford, you should hear her.
So thank you very much. Yeah. We'll be thinking about this.
Yeah, I'm in your box.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks,
for your
guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It should be noted that Mitch told me that you had those numbers wrong, so I just brought it up.
That's funny. You didn't tell me.
Okay. So let's do old business number two. Get the Holly Road update and Laurel Drive.
Okay. So we did receive the release of the waivers of damages for the Holly Road residents. Those have been sent out to all the addresses where we send the tax bills. I was contacted by the real estate company that's addressing one of the properties that's for sale, so they have that information. They're going to get the signatures. So we're rolling along on this one.
And I was contacted by a member, for someone who lives on the road, that wanted to appreciate the DPW getting out there this week and fixing the pothole problems that they had out there and getting that straightened out. So, ironically, I got the phone call.
Good night.
Congratulations. All right, any other discussion about Holly and...
No. Nope.
All right.
Moving along.
All right, new business number one. We need to look at a contract for the secondary clarifier upgrades for wastewater treatment plant.
Thank you.
Evening.
I guess we already took care of the other one, the contract extension.
Oh, yeah, we took care of all that.
Yep.
That's a no-cost contract extension, just so I thought I mentioned that.
Yep.
For the secondary treatment plant, that's a mechanical facility that runs 24/7, 365. It never shuts down. The last time that treatment plant was upgraded was in 1988, so the mechanisms that are working and 4 million-gallon tanks have been running continuously for 27 years. We recently had the opportunity to drain the tank and take a look at the mechanisms. And down the bottom, there's supposed to be a bearing about that size. It was completely gone. The mechanism was literally just hanging by the rails up top and along the perimeter of the clarifier. Also, we noticed that some of the perimeter baffles, some of the scum troughs, the connectors into the walls and so forth, were completely rusted right off and deteriorated. So what this plan is to replace both mechanisms. The treatment plant has two secondary clarifiers. And what that does, it takes the biological solids from the aeration tanks, settles it out, returns the bugs, quote, quote, back to the process, the clarified water goes out, chlorination, and then to the river. And that mechanism is required to scrape all of the bacteria and the sludge and put that back into the process. So if something, God forbid, ever happened to one of the two, then the single clarifier operating would be at twice capacity, be borderline whether you met permit or not. I'd be concerned that you may not meet effluent quality permit standards. So we're recommending that we prepare plans and specifications. It'd be five sheets which would show existing equipment, proposed new equipment, proposed retrofits to the original design. And by that I mean, instead of putting steel back in for the perimeter longer, as they call it in our business, where the effluent goes over the weirs, that would now be fiberglass. Instead of regular steel bolts, it would now be stainless steel, 3/16, and it would be a system that I think would even last longer than the current system. So we're proposing to prepare plans and specifications for contract bidding, assist in the bidding process, work with the Department of Public Works, and go out, solicit quotations, review the bids, and recommend a low bidder, reasonable low bidder for award. So that's, I don't know if you received a copy of our letter dated April 21st, which outlines that. And
April?
Yes.
Do you have any sense of the magnitude of total cost we'd be looking at?
It's already been appropriated.
Right, $207,000.
Okay.
Yeah, so, you know, there's a risk there that we've already appropriated money and we don't have the bids anymore.
Yep.
But we're optimistic that clarifier design hasn't changed much over the years, and it's not new technology, it's existing technology that works. And so we're hopeful that the bids will come in below what has been appropriated.
Mm-hmm. So what are you looking for us for tonight?
To approve it. Approve the contract.
Approve our contract.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And was this part of the capital improvement plan? Is this part
clarifier
of the...
It's number one priority.
Yeah.
It's the number one
number
priority.
Number one, right. Okay. Just
for
making sure.
Wastewater.
Yep. I'll make a motion to have them go out to bid. Is that what I want to do?
No, to accept their contract.
To accept
the contract. Okay.
Accept the contract with tie and bond for to do the design work.
Second.
Any other questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. What's the condition of the second clarifier?
Well, we didn't drop it, but being at the same age, same waist, day in and day out, it's like you have four tires on a car. When one's probably bald, most likely the others are the same.
Is the engineering going to be the same if we decide to do this next year? We won't have to pay the engineering fee again, I correct?
Oh,
we'll be able
both.
To utilize
doing both.
Okay.
We're
doing both.
Yeah, both going to be done. We'll stagger them, obviously.
Okay.
And we like to do the actual construction during lower flow periods so that we're not overloading them when we clarify that it's
one. What is goes, the other one goes.
Right.
So you just take it offline?
Pardon?
You just take it offline?
Yes.
Yeah.
What is your low flow period?
Depends on the precipitation, but this year, all year has been relatively dry. Groundwater table.
So it's pretty constant. You have the same flow. It's pretty constant flow.
In your town, you do. You have a remarkably tight sewer system. Probably one of the tightest I've seen. By that, I mean a lot of the pipes have joints that tend to leak if the groundwater table is above it. But your operator had sent out an email showing the comparison during wet weather, dry weather flow. It was barely noticeable during wet weather conditions, the influence of a storm event into your sewer system.
So we don't have a bigger flow during like shopping season, but Thanksgiving to Christmas. That's
you have some diurnal changes that would be noticeable, but it's insignificant. It might go from 300 to 330,000 a day.
Huh.
It's not 300 to 500,000 like say some communities during a storm event. they look at the charts, storm, you know, you have a good fortune, the system's been maintained.
Summer, students.
Wow.
Okay.
I always just wonder about seasonal things. Mm-hmm. All right, yeah. So it's been approved. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so we have two items left before we go back into executive session. Yes?
Do we need Michael for anything else?
No. So the two items, the one we really need to talk about is annual town meeting schedule and action items. And then we've also been talking about some non-binding questions during the election for the override. Mm-hmm. I kind of think we might want to talk about them together, because we lay out we talk about the schedule for our annual town meeting, we might come up with some ideas that we might want to do for some questions. Although we can't do questions on the ballot, we would have to do a informal type of questioning.
So at the last select board meeting, you asked about getting a non-binding ballot question on the special election that's coming up in mid-January, and we thought that we could do it, but then it turns out by law you can only have non-binding ballot questions on your annual election, which would be April 12th, if I remember correctly.
It just blows my mind that a non-binding question can't go on a special.
We agree. We don't understand the reason for it, but it is a law.
Okay.
I think a copy of it is in your book.
Yep.
Okay,
so thank you for the update.
Let's talk about annual town meeting schedule.
April 12th.
Well, we need to talk a little more about the schedule for.
Right. So I've presented to you a proposed calendar for the. Annual town meeting, which is May 5th, 2016, everybody.
Are we already in trouble? Because isn't today the 18th?
No, we're not in trouble. I always build in shoulders into this stuff. So theoretically, today we're meeting with the Finance Committee and the School Committee to establish budget guidelines. I understand that you still have a remaining SWOT analysis to hear from a large part of your budget. So. November 18th is not going to happen, but perhaps we could think about your first or second meeting in December to establish marching orders for the departments. During the last department head meeting, we talked about working on the budgets so people aren't doing them on Christmas Eve. Deadline for all budgets, January 13th. Oh, selectmen open the warrant on January 6th. With a deadline of February 17th, that's your usual window. Deadline of January 13th for the budgets. Annual reports due on February 17th as well. Capital Planning Committee completes whatever capital budget report they need to do, and I recognize most of that is done for the fall town meeting. On April 6th, we complete the warrant and send it for legal review. April 12th are your elections. April 13th is your legal review is complete, and then the last date to post the warrant is April 28th. So as you can see, between the 13th of April and the April 28th, you have plenty of time to work through any remaining issues. And then May 5th is town meeting.
Does this align with the schedule that we approved? For the budget process?
It's as close to a line as we could make it, given that we're still doing the SWOT analysis.
SWOT analysis. The capital, I guess the only date that I'm kind of worried about is the March 4th date for the Capital Planning Committee completing the capital budget report.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that really significantly informs maintenance and things like that in the regular budget, and, you know, kind of that whole domino thing. Is there any way to try to get that done any earlier? Or?
Well, they can try.
Well,
I think that's their deadline.
No, it's not a deadline because we haven't voted it yet.
Well, the capital budget submission process is in August, so they have those capital budgets already. They can start working on the capital budgets right now.
So that was I think what we had talked about with the original timeline that we presented, so that we would move that whole capital planning process up so that we're not
2 a.m.
Yeah, and sitting here at the meeting going, oh, that's capital, that's capital, that, you know, like we do every year.
I thought we spoke more to the fact that since we didn't really understand our budget numbers, that the capital, most of the capital planning should be done at the fall special town meeting rather than at the annual town meeting.
We did that too.
We
but
did,
then
but,
we got to skip the starting point.
So no, I agree, but I don't anticipate the capital planning line item to be as significant as it was in the fall.
Oh, this, I kind of feel this annual town meeting is going to have a huge capital.
Buildings are part of capital.
So.
Yeah.
But there should already be a list of where they work off of.
Yeah, that's,
so I mean, that's half of the battle right there to work off of the list they have already. So that's, that part of work is already done.
Mm-hmm. So the 19th, tomorrow, the Finance Committee's meeting, is, I didn't see on their agenda where they were going to talk about trying to set some, what they thought would be the goals for the budgets, mm-hmm. what they would possibly recommend to us as being... Mm-hmm. The goals, that wasn't on their agenda, was it?
No. Well, I think that Mr. Kopacki is working with people who are new to municipal finances, and he's bringing them up to speed.
Okay.
So there is a section in there where they're going to be going over the Finance Committee handbook, and during that discussion, they can be touching upon the kinds of goals that they need to establish for the annual top meeting.
Okay. I'll reach out and talk to him and see how he plans to do that. Does anybody plan to go to that meeting?
Yeah, I'm going to try to be there if I have wheels.
What time are they meeting?
7 in this room.
Here?
Yeah.
I thought it was public safety.
It was already booked, so they're meeting here.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Because that's really, I mean, if you really want to move this, I mean, they're supposed to make us for the recommendation of a recommendation to us that they think this is what should be the increase for the year and so forth. So that's supposed to be the sort of a starting point for us.
Well,
so I was just kind of curious if they were going to try to do that this year.
Yeah, but we also have this 5-year projection, and we had agreed that we would agree on the revenue so we knew how much we had to spend.
Correct.
Right.
But you have a finance committee that's actually, somebody on a finance committee has done it and they're going to try to go by the Finance Committee rule book, so I'm kind of curious how they're going to do it the other way, too.
But do they have all of this information?
Yes.
They have this, they have the original schedule, they have a copy of the SWOT analyses, all that stuff?
I don't think they've got SWOT analysis. We'll make sure that they get that.
Yeah, I mean, I just, you know, want them to make us informed.
I take that back. I think I sent that out to...
Right.
To Mark, at least, yeah. Right. It's just because it's been complete turnover.
It has. So my other question... Open the warrant on the 6th. When do we have, what's the deadline for us to have to close the warrant?
Technically a week before town meeting.
A week before.
But I don't recommend that.
No, but technically.
You don't have to close the warrant until you're ready to sign it.
Which is the week before town meeting.
Right.
Okay.
You can always close it on the designated date, and if you have to open it, you can always reopen it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. What I kind of want to try to avoid is we had a lot of articles in the fall town meeting, which didn't have a lot. We didn't have a lot of stuff worked out, so we don't close the warrant. Those don't just keep carrying forward. We can have them a little more vague until we work them out. So that's kind of what I was kind of hoping. Plus, I think we're going to have a lot of discussion. On other building issues. Does anybody else have any questions about the schedule?
No.
So, there's a nice row of people in the back still sitting here.
Do we have to vote on this?
We do. No, we don't. This is just the schedule we're going to work for. Accept it.
Right. So is the first date going to be December 9th rather than November 18th? That'll give you 2.
Yes, that's fine.
Okay, and okay. I'd like to, I think we need to keep talking about that capital.
Okay.
Yeah.
The other thing we need to talk about is buildings. So the building committee's been doing a great deal of work. The library committee's been doing a great deal of work.
Where's that on your agenda?
This is in the annual town meeting.
Okay.
So one of the things that the library is going to bring the annual town meeting is a, well, we, is a question on whether or not to proceed with applying for that grant, their library grant, right? Don't they? Building grant.
Yeah, library building grant.
So that's going to come forward as an article. As we talked about Nat before, that has an impact on the senior center.
And Park and Rec.
And Park and Rec. It also has an impact on all our other buildings, because the building committee has kind of laid out what they thought should be the priorities. So we need to sit down as a select board and entertain some more discussion about building committees or building processes. We also need to look at whether or not we take the public safety complex and do anything with that. We've talked a little bit about whether we want to have a full-time fire force. If we have a full-time fire force, that affects the public safety complex. If we have a part-time fire force, that affects public safety complex. If we have some type of ambulance service, that affects it. The building committee has kind of said that building is probably one of the ones we need to look at first now, as I believe. And as I get shaking heads from the back row.
Nodding heads, yes.
Yeah. I get an affirmative answer from the back row. So that kind of leads it to us as a select board that we need to sit down with our chiefs and go through what they're proposing in their budgets a little sooner and talk about what we look forward in the future for those departments and where we want to head.
We better set a fire underneath getting rid of that building in North Hadley so you can make some final decisions on these other projects.
Well, doing a needs analysis has nothing to do with that building.
We've already done that. It has nothing to do with this.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with it.
It hasn't been for sale yet. It's not gone anywhere yet.
It's toast.
Being held up by the Historical Commission.
Well, they need to get a fire under them.
Let's just say we do need to do that, but there's another fire that needs to be lit under us because we have to decide and kind of come to some conclusion on what we want to do with public safety. The building committee feels that's where the main focus should be on. If that's the case, then we need to make some adjustments in how things are going. The library committee is moving forward, and their movement affects two other departments right now. So we also need to figure out how we're gonna fit that all in. We had a very good meeting last night. And for those who are watching this on tape, this is tape, so it's not live. For those who are watching it, that was the Tuesday, the 17th. We met with the building committee and some of the library trustees, and we talked about their timeline, how they're set up. They have to actually stay on the schedule they're at, or else they fall off the window, and we risk losing 50% of state funds to pay for this project. So we need to, as a select board, need to be working more with that group, the library and the building committee, in addition to lay out what we want to do or how we think we can handle this and bring it all together.
I think this is a townwide decision. I don't think that's for this board to do.
Go ahead.
So that I think that that we need to set up a committee, and I think we should incorporate all the committees in the town. I mean, I want planning and everybody else at the table. You've had absolutely zero luck with getting people out to the forums to try to address these issues and talk about them. If the people in this town want a full-time fire department, let's let them speak. At this point in time, I don't feel comfortable telling them that's what they need. There just needs to be some way to better do this, and I don't think it's a matter of the five of us up here directing that we're going to have a full-time fire department down at Hadley.
Well, I agree with you to a point. However, I do think what's under the purview of the select board, unfortunately, whether we like it or not, is to exhibit some sort of leadership. And
I don't think is a denial of leadership.
No, I'm not.
Under
I'm
any circumstances.
Okay.
But what I'm saying is that I think that it's our job to make sure that all the facts, that as best we can, are put together in front of the town meeting, town constituency, in some sort of meaningful way so that there's a presentation that makes sense and that has to be led with the experts that we have on staff in public safety. And we haven't even ourselves really felt that we've had that yet. So I think what Guilford's talking about is before we go ahead and just throw it out to the town and have a free-for-all, we have to get enough information in front of us so that we know how to frame it, and when I say frame it, I'm not talking about hiding anything or manipulating anything. I'm just talking about like what Mike did tonight. How do you present information in a meaningful way so that people understand it, they get their questions asked, and then absolutely, Jerry, I completely agree with you. It's really up to the residents and the voters of the town to make the ultimate decision. But I think, you know, we're falling woefully behind in getting that information out there. I mean, even all of this stuff around the library. I mean, town meeting voted to spend the funds or allocate the funds to kick off this project. The project's been laid out from day one, and then everybody seems to be surprised about it all. So
I think
last night
I
was
think
a good
the
meeting.
Surprise was not necessarily the surprise about the expansion of the library. The surprise was that they were knocking down the senior center and putting their building there. That was the surprise.
Well, the surprise is that's their recommended option.
Exactly.
That's
it's a site selection process.
That's their most selected piece that they want to do with displacing other people.
So
that was no discussion amongst anybody else.
So what they've done is given an option. They've worked through their process and given options. Jerry's right. We need to have a group of people come together to lay out mm-hmm. the options, which is mm-hmm. what we're all saying here. Because even when we talk to the people and we let the people decide what they want to do, they're going to say, well, what are our options? If we do this, do we get this? Mm-hmm. Do we do this? Do we get this? That's where we, as the select board, need to pull it together. And yes, we do need to build a bigger group. When we met with the library and the building committee, we realized that, yes, there needs to be seniors need to be in there, park and rec need to be in there. We probably need to have historical commission in there because it affects some historical buildings. We need to have
planning board
in there because it's a bigger thing. We do need to bring more people to the table, and we truly only have between now and May to put together an argument of what and lay out the options that are available, or else we'll go to annual town meeting with one option. And that'll be the school, that'll be the library who decided that their best option is to tear the building down, evict some people, and build there.
And we would have no plan.
And then that'll probably go nowhere because
I don't think the needs of the library are what should drive the growth of this town.
Correct. So we need to have all the options laid out, which is what we're all saying here at
and
the same time.
This is the same deal, and I have to go back to when I was on the school building committee when we were building the elementary school. We had several different options. We could not get the people to come out to come to the forums. So the only other alternative that we did was we sent a survey. And that was the driven thing that made us do what we did in building the school that we built.
So now
so now we're back to that. You're,
that was seven town meetings, by the way. Seven votes.
Seven?
Seven.
You know, seven town meetings.
Seven votes.
Your mother was involved with that to beat the band, and I'll tell you, I think the survey is the way that we're going to end up going and asking people what they want to do with buildings, park and rec, all these library, everything of that nature. I think that's the only way you're going to get people to respond.
You know, unfortunately, we've had several surveys at this point. We've asked people many times, and it's just going to be a waste of time. And I think we've even had discussions about people saying, why are we doing another survey? So I think where we've come about this is, and the library didn't go out and decide to knock down that building on their own. We, in our efforts to evaluate the buildings, we were feeling, as the buildings committee, that one had the most likeliness of tearing down at least the back section of it, the newer section, just because of the way it's oriented with having to go down into the basement, or you got to go upstairs, you're going to need an elevator, that kind of thing. So it just came about as we're evaluating the front portion of the building that we're concerned that there may not be anything there to be able to renovate either because of the seismic requirements if we do change the use of the building.
Right.
So that therefore made it a little bit easier for us to let that building go. So it's not to say that the library has to go there, but it's an option for them. It was the best option for them. They could certainly put it in the back field. That's still an option, but we haven't crossed that bridge. But the other part of this whole discussion is the public safety building. Right now, it serves the purpose, but it's the people that are there are outgrowing the building. They don't have enough locker space for police. Fire department doesn't have enough room for their equipment. So as we've had the fire chief come in to explain, he feels that it's time to expand somehow. Maybe it means going full time. But just like the police chief just did tonight,
he did a great explanation of why to add another person. So I think the fire chief needs to do similar and explain why either we need a full-time force or a part-time force. And I don't think it's up to the townspeople necessarily to tell him what he needs. He's going by what he knows by these studies. He's telling everybody what the studies are saying. So I think we just need to get that information out there and make a decision. We are waiting to see what we're going to do with that building, because part of what came out of last night's discussion is we could expand the fire station there by putting more dormitories, another bay if we need it, whatever. We could move the police department somewhere else if we have to, give them a better protected building. But we can't make any decisions until we know what we want to do with that building and with that personnel. As for North Hadley, I mean, it's kind of, it's moving forward, but it's not as critical now because part of that discussion was, do we need a part-time station up there? Do we need that extra station? Maybe we don't if we're going full-time, which has been discussed already. So that's where we have to make this decision, either part-time or full-time. So between the next 10 and 20 years, that's going to drive what we're doing with everything. Mm-hmm. So that's why we feel that building needs to get figured out. Because if both public safety departments need to leave, then that building is vacant. Therefore, we can put something else in there. If it stays as public safety, then we have to figure out what to do with other people that may be moving. Maybe they get a new building. So that's what we're juggling right now. So we got to make a decision to move some direction.
So we have until May, basically, to put together all our options and have this discussion.
And so Mike has prepared, you know, an analysis. I do know that. On what the needs are, so he just needs to come in.
We need to come in. Mm-hmm. So we probably need to have him come in sooner rather than later to talk about that. And then
we need to know what's going where so we can look at the piece of property to fit the police department in or a parking lot and or a fire department, so that we can take a look at it and find some pieces where they would fit in. I mean, take the police department, but it would do no good up in North Hadley. So, you know, it's got to be somewhere central. So there's a lot of things that we've got to look at, and we've got to know what's what. And the library moving ahead, we're kind of against that right at the moment, only because, like you said, once they take over that, where do we put the park and rec? Again, that could go out in the back field. Then again, we put the park and rec, we're still looking for property, maybe, for the police department, if the police department's going to leave. So we don't know where we're supposed to be looking and for what.
Well, that's what we're trying to do, Willie, is come up with a timeline and basically a project plan that has key deliverables of information, key decision points, and fit that in. So. I mean, I think that's the most critical thing. Even if we don't decide the whole timeline, at least what the first couple of steps are in this process. And we've identified the public safety as point number one.
Exactly. We want to know where our next step is going to be.
Yep. Correct.
Is headed.
So I think kind of it's a multiple step thing here, but we have to keep it both all the paths moving forward. So we need to kind of make this bigger group to meet with other groups and talk, and then we need to have the fire department come in and talk to us as well. So there's multiple things going on, and we kind of need to fit it all into the schedule we have here.
Does Pioneer Valley Planning Commission do any of this professionally for towns?
Well, they're doing the whole master plan thing on December 3rd.
Which has got nothing to do with buildings.
No.
We did get a solicitation for direct local technical assistance. That tends to be a regional issue, but we can see if they can come up and offer some planning services for the reorganization of the buildings.
And if it's not them, are there other organizations out there that do such things?
There are.
Yeah.
We have to pay them.
Yeah.
I think this is a pretty significant, I think you're talking about the next 25, 30 years of the town of Hadley, and I think before, you know, they put an independent cost analysis to some of these things, that we're talking about, whether it's libraries or police departments or safety complexes or senior centers, you're talking millions and millions and millions of dollars.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that it behooves us to look at all the professional options that are available to us to try to understand where we should go with our growth and where our buildings are used. Our seismic is going to give us a lot of information as to what is going to be available to us, and we're currently working on that with the two buildings, you know, that we have there. And I think that this is, a 20-year plan that you're looking at. So I think people need to understand that and then see some type of plan that's put in front of us. And if it's not a full-time fire department this year, if we're working towards it and then 5 years from now, because of the needs of the community and the growth and the needs of the community, then we at least can begin to plan and look forward to that and where we need that to be. It gives us time available now in the interim period to buy lots and things that we need, whether it's behind the senior center, available land that we know, the 12 acres that's available, that. I've heard about a complex and putting a complex back there with a town hall and senior center and a library are all in an area that's specific to that area. Then what do you do with town hall? What do you do with Russell School? What do you do with the library currently there if you're not going to be utilizing that? The number that you're talking about here is not something that's going to be ready for town meeting.
But I think that
the choices have to be there for town meeting to know. When you make this decision, this is where you're laying things out. And if you make this decision, this is the path you're going down. That's how I understand what you're saying. Yeah, we need to give them that information, or else people are not going to make the decisions, and they're going to say no to everything.
And not to belittle the wonderful work that you guys have done either, because it's been significant.
And I think that's where the messaging from this, everybody on the select board is critical, because, you know, I think obviously the first thing people think about when you think about buildings are multi-millions of dollars. And I've had people come up to me and say, that's ridiculous. We can't build all of that within 3 years. And I was like, so that's why this plan is so important. To Jerry's point, this is a multi-year, potentially multi-decade process. And people need to understand that nobody's going to come to a town meeting asking them to authorize, you know, $35 million in one fell swoop. Yes. It's not going to happen, and I hope all of us are discouraging that thought.
I mean, the rough idea that Dave Tudrin came up with is it's 5 years. It could be 5 years before you even end up with a couple of these buildings the way we're talking about now. So that's just 5 years for two buildings. So as we talk about, this is a decades-long course of action we're taking, because don't want the tax rate that a neighbor may have.
And the timing on the library, same thing. I mean, we're talking a couple of years out, even if everything according to Hoyle, the way that their plan is laid out.
It's 4 years until that is...
Well, there's a lot of unanswered questions there too.
So, mm-hmm. So my thought process is aligned with Jerry and Molly a bit here. We need to have this bigger committee and bring a lot more people to the table, and then we need to have this laid out and what we're going to do. There's been surveys and no one's really answered them. So the question is, do we do surveys or do we not try to do a survey?
Well, I don't think now is imminent right now, but no. I think down the road when there has to be choices made, then that's when the survey goes out. I'm not saying now, but when there's time that we need to make some choices about buildings, you may want to do it then.
Okay.
Or you do
but
visioning.
But not necessarily at this point, but...
Do visioning sessions and see how many people... I mean, if we can actually get people to visioning where they say, okay, here's a picture of what this might look like, I mean, a picture is far more impactful, I think.
It's getting the people to come to the meeting.
But Joyce, we've done all board meetings before where we bring every single board and put them in the same room and say, okay, everybody, this is what we're talking about now, and this is why we need your input. Well, you know, truly those are a lot of the people that are going to be interested in what's going on. And now you have, instead of eight people in an audience listening, you have 100 people in a room that are on all committees, and you invite everybody. Mm-hmm. And you put them in the same room and you say, it's going to take everybody here to get this process started. Mm-hmm. We're looking for a committee to form from that, mm-hmm. and to grow from that.
So we did that when would be a good time to start, does anybody think? I mean, we're at Thanksgiving and we have Christmas. Do we try to shoot for something like that in the middle of December, in the first part of December, which is almost here?
I think we need to try to get it
done. I think after the first of the year. I don't think you're going to get anybody. I think people are too busy between now and the first of the year.
How about the first or second meeting of January?
No, don't do it at our meeting. Yeah, set up all board meeting.
What if we actually don't do our meeting in January, the second week of January, and we have this meeting at that meeting instead?
I think it's great. That would be just...
Although we do need to talk to the finance committee about the tri-board and seeing how we're going to go with that.
And I think getting public safety engaged in advance of that.
Yeah, I'm kind of looking at public safety needs to come in December and talk to us. So we'll lay out public safety coming in December to start talking to us, and then we'll shoot for an all boards meeting the second week of January. So we'll add that to this kind of informal schedule we have for town meeting.
What's building group's
That's
reaction?
What we're looking for.
But is that time frame?
Well, it just makes it tighter towards the May direction, but you know we'll lose 2 months there.
We might.
Well, we're still going to fire.
Well, I'm just saying, for us, the meeting, try to get stuff together.
But we're going to have fire and safety come in December.
Whoever's going to work out.
But there are.
We're already at the end of November.
There are two things you guys are working on now that if the answers come back negative on, that solves a lot of problems right there.
The seismic.
Both seismic. Every answer we get helps.
And yes.
Even just deciding on public safety. If we could take it off the table, then we've got another direction.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
So whatever we can solve.
So we got to keep all our paths moving.
Yep, and there's a lot of paths. You know, every one is related to the other. And,
yes.
And at that meeting, we could have the library, the senior center.
Every committee.
Everybody.
Every person on every committee.
You name it.
No, it's
okay.
Unfortunate that it happened the way it did with the library. You know, we are kind of behind all the time, essentially, because they have a set schedule and moving forward, and that's the way it came out. You know, if we had more time, if we had another 2 years, we could have put this in some sort of order.
But it just
couldn't.
So. No, it is what it is.
Yeah.
At least we're not building a school, too.
But still, we're talking about it, which is important, so we're going forward. So.
The library committee, they have... you know, they have a valid reason to go after what they're going after. Mm-hmm. There's an opportunity for them to build a facility that will be used for the next 35 years.
Yeah, longer.
That particular facility is going to be much more efficient. It's going to suck a lot less energy than mm-hmm. you know, it might take as much energy as they're taking now, maybe a little less. Even though the building is three times bigger. The one thing that we did decide on, I mean, the building committee is 100%, we've all decided that the Hooker School building is just not compatible with modern use. It's got everything going against it, and that building is gonna have to go. Whether the library goes there or a new senior center goes there, most likely that building is not going to be useful for us.
And I'm sorry I didn't look at your meeting last night, but if you're thinking of the same way for that senior center, Hooker School, what would be the point of keeping Goodwin Memorial Library up when it's not really accessible or handicap accessible or bathrooms?
That's a valid question.
Why not take down both of them and put something there that would be useful to another department?
If we're going to
be doing that, you know what I mean?
I can only imagine what historical commission's thinking right now.
Well, I was at that meeting the other day, and I'd be happy to run that by you after the meeting.
They're ready to hang me. I know.
That's the best looking building in town, best maintained, and we want to keep some of the character of Hadley in the center of town. We start tearing that down, making it modern, you know. We're going to change the whole town.
Yeah, there's historical.
But what you could put there would certainly be
limited.
Another historical building that would last another 100 years when we're not here.
Yeah. Well,
so what's here in the center of town, you can still aesthetically put another building there that would carry this town through another 100 years after we're gone.
A building's a building,
but you have to look at how and the usefulness of it is too.
Yeah. And you're not going to get any bigger a building, though, because the footprint can't be much bigger than what's there.
You can't build a historical building. It's only historical 100 years after the fact.
Okay, so we kind of accomplished what I wanted to accomplish, was we know we need to make a bigger committee, and we need to get the public safety in here to talk sooner.
All right, let's go for it.
So, is there anything else anybody wants to talk about town meeting? And
no, let's move on.
Any announcements now?
I do. Again, I'd like to, I'm more prepared this time. I'd like to talk about the holiday fair on November 21st. That's this Saturday, between 9 and 3 at the Hopkins Academy cafeteria. They now have over 60 vendors that are going to be there. And again, I'm supposed to mention that the Polish pottery will be back this year. So that was a big point. Come shop for your holiday gifts, visit Santa, lunch menu, silent auction, hourly door prizes, bake table, bring non-perishable items for the Hadley Food Pantry, and receive a raffle ticket. Again, it's going to be the biggest one I think that they've ever had, and I know they're working very hard on it.
Okay.
I just say would like to say happy Thanksgiving to everybody this coming week.
All right. Master plan. Go ahead.
Okay. The Hadley Master Plan Public Forum is going to be happening Thursday, December 3rd, card night. It's at 6:30 p.m. at the Hadley Senior Center at the Hooker School.
My birthday.
Is it December 3rd?
Again, that's December 3rd at the Hadley Senior Center. And again, the planning boards work very hard at updating the master plan, and that information is going to be available. This is our town. Please come to the forum and add your input to what's being put together so that we have that plan to go forward with.
Great.
And we'd also like to make mention that one of our board members was received a very big honor in the last 2 weeks. Congratulations, Joyce. You have X amount of years over at the hospital. I don't know if you wanted to make mention of how long you were there and that you delivered Lincoln's birth baby.
I've been working there 45 years.
Wow. Congratulations, Joyce.
Thank you.
Okay, any other announcements?
Go make a motion to go into executive session for personnel issue.
And
not to reconvene in open session.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Good night.
And negotiations.
Contract negotiations.
Contract negotiations with non-union personnel.
Non-union personnel.
Yeah. Okay. So there's a second.
Second.
Divine?
Yay.
Maureen?
Yes.
John Glow?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Okay, good night, everybody.
Good night.
Forgetting something, you've got to read that statement.
Oh, I forgot to read a statement. As chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the board has moved and seconded to enter into an executive session. I state that the discussion of the matter in open session would have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley, and we will not reconvene, and I apologize for not reading that. So.